cook on the RedStorm Wheelhouse. I'm your moderator, Dariel Tolentino, and today, my guest and I will discuss the ins and outs of the upcoming seasons for St. John's Athletics and professional New York sports. Let's get down to business. All right, so today I'm accompanied by two amazing analysts. Today we have Missy Dunlap and Mike Grudio. How are you guys doing today?
Doing great. Happy here to talk some sports. Happy here to talk about how Bryce Harper was not on the winning Nationals team. So great discussions ahead.
Amazing.
Yeah, I'm absolutely extravagant to be here today. And I'm excited to talk not just New York sports, but our own St. John's sports.
Of course. And on that note, let's just get right into it. So last Wednesday, we saw Mike Anderson's coaching debut after a very controversial coaching search at the beginning of last April. We see, you know, this team has been through a lot. We saw them finally make a push for the tournament last year, so it's very exciting. And with the unceremonial firing of Chris Mullin, we now see Mike Anderson taking the wheel. So I guess our first question, I'll go over to you, Missy, is can Mike Anderson save St. John's basketball?
So I think Mike Anderson was probably one of the greatest picks that St. John's could have done for this season, because what they needed was pure experience. Mullin obviously was good for the scouting efforts. People want to play for Chris Mullin, and that's great. Obviously, coaching on the sideline, we didn't get the outcomes that we wanted. And obviously now we also don't have two key players in Justin Simon and obviously Shamori Ponds as they are pursuing their NBA careers. So right now we need to work with the talent that we have, and we need a strong leader doing that. So I think having the experience in Mike Anderson, great person to have. Also, I love the energy that he brings. He's fun to watch on the sidelines. And on top of it, he loves this school already. You can tell his spirit. He can walk around campus, be friendly to students, to faculty, encouraging them to come to the games. On tip-off, he was handing out t-shirts in line, just excited to get people excited about St. John's basketball again. So I think that was a great start to see. Obviously, great first game against Mercer that they obviously should have won that well, but very great to see a great start from the Johnnies and a really great start to Mike Anderson's career at St. John's University.
Yeah, completely agreed. And like we talk about Mike Anderson and his previous coaching ventures and how great of a coach he is. He's never had a losing season in his career. We got to talk about the players themselves. I mean, this team has a lot of doubts coming into the season now that, like we said, Justin Simon is gone, as well as Shamori Ponds. But they still have Mustafa Heron. They still have Figueroa. They have talent. They have new incoming freshmen that are looking to provide firepower. We shouldn't count them out. I believe that, obviously, this is a bit of a transitional season, but they have a lot of firepower throughout the whole lineup and bench. And with a coach like Mike Anderson in there, who's going to give that winning attitude, not just a well-known name like Chris Mullin, I believe that we should anticipate some good things coming out of men's basketball this year.
I think you look at this St. John's team as well, and I think the key to our success, obviously not this year but into the future, is our recruiting. This year is going to be very important to me personally for Mike Anderson's career here at St. John's, because depending on what this year they do in the Big East tournament, in the Big East league play and everything like that, it's going to attract the New York native high school players. This year, we managed to pick up Brooklyn native Julian Champagne, who, you know, was fantastic in that game against Mercer. So I think that's really going to be the key for us. Can Mike Anderson recruit? Can he do it effectively? And can he get this team to really rally in those high tense moments where they lacked last year? So moving on from men's basketball, we're going to move into women's basketball. This is Joe Tardamello's eighth season as head coach for these Johnnies. Last year sort of ended kind of poorly, but this year they are bringing back their trio of starters in Alicia Kebby, Tiana England, and Kadashi Hobby. A lot of things are expected of this team, and we've seen Joe Tardamello. We know what he's capable of doing. And so our next question to you, Mike, can Joe Tardamello make it back to the NCAA championship?
I definitely believe that they can. I don't think there's a question if he can do it. I believe there's a question if the players can do it. I believe that this team is the deepest and one of the best they've had in years. And I think Joe Tardamello has a really good roster on his hands to possibly make a push in the Big East. You saw in their opening game coming out with a win, Tamia England and Leilani Corin playing really well. And I believe that they have a lot of potential to move some heads and be the movers and shakers in the Big East and possibly make a push to get into the postseason.
Yeah, and hey, Big East women's basketball is exciting to watch. And having a coach that really is spirited like ours is only going to make this season better for the team. As you mentioned, they have some key players coming back, and they have a pretty good a pretty good set going out there, and I think that they definitely have potential to take it pretty far. I think this could definitely be a season that they're making it back to the tournament. They're playing strong, and any Johnnies watching, you should go check out the women's basketball team. I know that Carnesecca Arena gets packed for those men's games and not as packed for those women's games, but I'm telling you, it is electric to watch this team play season to season, regardless of the outcome. They are a strong woman, so you want to go watch them play. It's a really great experience as a St. John's student.
Yeah, Joe Charmello has done a fantastic job. In his 8 seasons with the Johnnies, obviously discounting this 8th season, in the past 7, he's been to the postseason 6 times. 3 of those times were actually in the NCAA tournament, which is why we're even asking the question, because we know he can get back to that point. Last year was a little bit of a rough year. As we mentioned before, they finished 8th overall in the Big East. But this year, I really do think we have a good chance. This is a very underrated team, even here on campus, when we always focus on the men's basketball team. It's easy to overlook a great team in that team, which is very consistent over the years. But just to move on, going from one team in the shadows to another, because St. John's has more than just one team. It's not just a basketball team, ladies and gentlemen. It's also several other sports, including the men's soccer team, which has been on fire. All right, as of their last game against Providence, they did lose, but that does move their record to 13-3-1 in overall play, 6-2-1 in Big East. Now they are number 2 in the nation. No, in the nation? I'm sure it's if not in the nation, in the Big East, definitely. only behind Georgetown, and that's who we're looking to play against. So going into this postseason, Missy, we'll go to you. Exactly what can we expect from the Johnnies? Can they beat this Georgetown team?
So in the nation is a little enthusiastic, but they are the number 2 seed in the Big East right now, scheduled to play Georgetown. I mean, I definitely think they're going to put up a fight. Obviously, their last play against Georgetown didn't end the way that they did, the way that we would want to see it happen. And their last game, a Big East play, they did fall to Providence, which was an upsetting loss for the Johnnies. But I think that if they really just put their trust in their key players, control that midfield, play a defensive game, but when you have that spurts of offense against Georgetown, take advantage of it, catch them on their toes. I definitely think that there's great potential. Again, Georgetown is a fun team to play and a fun team to watch all around in all Big East play. But it's exciting to see that men's basketball is actually, men's soccer is actually a contender against them this season, because again, they're one of the top, and we haven't been able to really contend against them. So getting to see them play and play hard against them is going to be a fun game to watch coming up.
Yeah, and you see it not just with the team, but with the fans. Belson Stadium is packed very often. Mm-hmm. That soccer field is always has those lights shining bright on them, and they've had a phenomenal season to start off. And as for playing Georgetown, yes, they lost the last game, but I believe that they have the right attitude coming in to the postseason, and I believe that they can make a push as long as they hold on to, like you said, that strong midfield and having a good defensive game plan to limit scoring, because scoring is not a problem for the Johnnies. They already have Tani Oluwase, who's the leading scorer in the Big East, so they have no problems scoring the ball as long as they can shed that, as long as they can block their goal. I believe that if they have a good defensive game plan, they can make big moves in the Big East.
Yeah, you both make really good points. As you know, St. John's is known for their up speed tempo. They've been a very high scoring team this past season and been absolutely electrifying. Although we saw in that loss against Georgetown, they were shut out 3-0, which is very uncharacteristic of these Johnnies. So it's very interesting to see exactly what they can do in the postseason, how they can respond to that loss against Georgetown, see how much they took away from that game, see what they can do. It really does come down to defense, mm-hmm. stopping those plays. And like you said before, Missy, in the midfield, of course, with the keepers, both teams have great keepers, and both teams are so similar, it's very hard to see those differences, and really it comes down to whoever makes the first mistake.
Yeah, right. That's a good point.
Moving on from college sports, although we love it and we love our Johnnies, we're going to move into the New York local teams in the professional circuit. First off, let's go on to basketball, because we are a basketball team, or a basketball school, rather. We have 2 teams in New York this year. The Knicks and the Nets. Now, of course, historically, the Knicks have been the number 1 team in New York, but now the Nets have come over after signing not only Kyrie Irving and KD in the same year when we were supposed to get them. They've managed to make it to the playoffs last year without any of them, surprising everybody, although losing in the first round. Mike, we'll go to you. What do the Nets have to do to rip New York away from the Knicks?
Well, I believe it's really going to come down to just them showing that last season wasn't a fluke. Obviously, D'Angelo Russell was a great piece, and now he's gone, but they've replaced D'Angelo Russell with another all-star in Kyrie Irving. And then next year, hopefully, they'll be having KD coming back as well. So I think it's a matter of them just keeping a steady attitude and just allowing Kevin Durant to come in to a near flawless system. Just no bumps in the road, as long as they can keep a steady push going towards this year's postseason. I believe that the playoffs can be a good spot for Brooklyn, and next year is going to be just as good, especially with a big time all-star like Kevin Durant coming back.
Yeah, I mean, next year is something definitely looking forward to. One thing, just touching back on about the Knicks are Mets right now. There's no other way to put it. I know right now outside of MSG, I'm pretty sure there's an Irving poster that was posted that he's home. His home is in Brooklyn, and he's been very vocal about how he feels that New York basketball is really in Brooklyn. I think they have great potential. They're 3-4 right now, off to a little slow start in the beginning, but now really picking up that fire and that heat. I think the Nets, it's exciting. Go to Barclays Center, watch a game, because that stadium is definitely, that arena is definitely pumping, and it's a great place to watch some basketball, not in just the mecca of New York City.
Yeah, Barclays Center is a big step up from where the Nets used to be. Interesting stat that I managed to scrape up. In 2010, there was a certain game that the Nets had in Prudential Center, which holds 19,500 seats. Only 1,016 fans actually attended that game. So you see from that slow start to now this big hype after they moved to Brooklyn. Now they're in the Barclays Center, which is very state-of-the-art, very exciting to be in. But of course, the Knicks are in the mecca of basketball itself, Madison Square Garden. You know, they have such a storied history with some of the greatest NBA players of all time, Patrick Ewing, Willis Reed, Walt Frazier, Earl Monroe. It just goes on and on and on, and it's really tough for me personally to see the Nets really catch up to all that history and really capture those hearts. But at the end of the day, the Nets have everything that's going for them, you know? They have the best players. They have the best, at this point, really a strong fan base. So it's really interesting what happens in the next coming years. Personally, Knicks all day.
Yeah, but I think the Knicks also, it's even outside of basketball, inside the business right now, MSG's looking up to give up their equity in the Knicks, and that's a big thing, and because you got to get those fans in there, you got to get people excited, and you got to make money. So I think in all aspects, the Knicks really have to focus on their rebuilding, and hopefully they will, because watching a game in MSG is always a great experience, so let's hope our Johnnies can maybe pick up the pace at that arena this year.
All right, moving on from basketball, we'll go to another very, very popular sport here in New York. And Missy, if I understand, it is one of your favorite sports, baseball. So unfortunately, the World Series just wrapped up and the Yankees weren't even in it. It really sucks. They finished 103 with 103 wins, 59 losses, lost at ALCS to the Astros. Very unfortunate year. And you see this team and it's, you know, supposedly it's supposed to be really, really great, and yet they haven't been able to close it out. So, Missy, exactly what do the Yankees have to do not only to make it back to the World Series, but to win it, most importantly?
I'm sitting here smiling, not because I'm a Yankee hater, even though seeing the Yankees lose does bring a little joy to your heart as a Mets fan, but Aaron Boone let me down, even just as a New York sports fan. I feel that pitching was out of whack in the World Series, uncharacteristically though, because the Yankees pitching has been pretty solid all year. It's just something fell flat. And one reason that I knew that the whole series was kind of falling flat as well is just watching home from your TV. You could tell that just the electricity in that stadium, at Yankee Stadium particularly, was very dull. Yankees fans weren't on their feet as much as they should have been. There was just this kind of gloomy atmosphere of the final series that they played in, and I think it kind of led a little bit to their downfall. I mean, the Astros won that series. They deserved that series. Granted, they didn't go on to win the World Series, but they gave the Yankees a run for their money, and they really did come out strong with their pitching and all around really great series by the Astros, and really upsetting loss for the New York Yankees.
Yeah, the Yankees have a lot of questions coming into this offseason, but honestly, you know how New York is. We have all the money in the world, so we're already eyeing some of the players that were able to be in the World Series, unlike us. And I think that next year. Obviously, say this every year as a Yankee fan that, oh, it's going to be number 28. But this this offseason could be a little bit different. I mean, they have a lot of candidates. They're already going after Gerrit Cole of the Houston Astros. So Houston Astros could lose one of their three aces, and that could be a little bit of a dent to them. And the Astros are going to be looking to come back strong after that loss to the Nationals. And the league, honestly, is looking like it's wide open, and the Yankees can make that push that they've been trying to have for the past couple of years, because there's been a huge difference between the postseason New York Yankees and the regular season New York Yankees. And obviously, the New York season, the regular season Yankees have always been a superior team, because we haven't seen World Series baseball of the Yankees since Jeter was around. So obviously, there's a bit of a I'm trying to find the word. It's not disappointment, but it's definitely more so just urgency, because the Yankees are starting to lose some of that edge that they had when they had Judge coming up first. So they definitely did make moves, and this offseason looked like it could be a real key one for the New York Yankees.
I'm very excited for the Yankees' future, even though, yeah, I was kind of disappointed, because 100 wins is great, but it doesn't matter if you don't get the chip. And, you know, these Yankees, they have such great players. You mentioned Aaron Judge, but we also have guys like Gleyber Torres. Yeah. We have Aaron Hicks, Luis Severino. He was hurt, unfortunately, for most of the season, but he's still projected to come back, and he did come back in the playoffs, and he did pretty well. We have guys like Gary Sanchez. We have, you know, these other players that, you know, came out of nowhere, temporary players they were supposed to be. DJ LeMahieu, Gio Urshela, Mike Tauchman, Mike Ford. The list goes on. This is a great baseball team. And really, I think it is down, like you guys mentioned, the pitching. These Yankees have already made a lot of offseason moves. Edwin Encarnacion, free agent. We're done with him. Chapman, you know, is extended to 2022. He's a great reliever for us. And then Matt Blake is now our new pitching coach. So definitely the Yankees have done their homework. Personally, 28. 28. We're coming back. We're coming back.
You definitely have good points there, for sure. And on paper, like, this year should have been the Yankees. I mean, like, when you looked at the beginning of the season, like, their pitching, it's crazy to talk about the downfall of their pitching, because when we were looking at the beginning of the season, there was only potential there. And the fact that it's not even that they screwed it up, it's just they didn't live up to their potential. And I think that's upsetting for New York baseball. But I don't know about 28, hoping not 28, but eventually 28 will be there soon, I think, within the next few years for the New York Yankees.
Right.
All right, moving on. I mean, we have this whole vibe with the Yankees. We know they're a championship team. Unfortunately, for most of New York sports, it hasn't been the same exact sentiment. We can see it in basketball with the Knicks and the Nets. We see it in football with the Giants and the Jets. And we're just moving on and on and on with every sport. There's been a lack of luster for championships here in New York. For such an amazing city, it's very uncharacteristic. So, Mike, I'm going to ask you, final question. Who is going to be the first New York team to bring a championship here?
Well, it's definitely a toss-up, because it's always unpredictable with us New York teams. I mean, you had, like, the Yankees this year. They could have been the ones, and obviously they fell. So you never know, based off any of the seasons, like, who can come up on top. My personal pick is going to be the Brooklyn Nets, just because they have so much potential, especially now they have KD coming back next year, and Kyrie this year obviously playing out of his mind. So my guess is the Brooklyn Nets, but honestly, with the unpredictability of all of the major professional leagues, there's so much uncertainty.
And my pick is the New York Jets. I am kidding. No. The Jets are not looking hot at all, and I'm a Jets fan saying that. But I know I'm going to get a little slack for this, but I really think that the Mets have something brewing and flushing. Like, I really do. Obviously, we have 15 back in a very different position. Carlos Beltran is now the manager of the New York Mets. Was a little hesitant personally as a Mets fan on the idea of it, especially because when you have such a recent player come back in a position like that, who had such a good relationship with the team, you don't want to see them fail, because then that kind of messes up their history with the team. And obviously, I'm rooting for Carlos Beltran. I think he can offer a lot to this team, not only because he was a great player, but I think he he has a lot of ambition for this team. He has a lot of love for the New York Mets organization, and I think he's going to bring good people here. Rumor has it that he is in talks with Terry Collins and bringing him back as a bench coach, and that is truly you don't know what you've lost until it's gone sort of situation, because Terry Collins was an excellent manager, especially during the 2015 season. He has spark, he has energy, something that I think Mickey Callaway did not have as his as a successor. But I think that the New York Mets have potential. I think if we can solid up our pitching, if we can maybe acquire people, which is a lot has been spoken about by our GM in the offseason, that they have the money to do this, and we never hear that the Mets have the money to do stuff. So now that it's vocally being said, I think that is outstanding. And we have talent. I mean, there is no doubt in my mind that Pete Alonso is going to win NL Rookie of the Year. There's no doubt in my mind that DeGrom's going to get his second Cy Young. I don't know. I think something is happening special in Flushing right now. Mark my words. I'm probably wrong, but I'm going to stick with my gut and root for my Mets.
Yeah, you know, you already know my pick, Yankees. Yankees. I'm calling it next year, right now. Right now, on recording, next year we're winning the next World Series, all right? I'm going to say in six against whoever. I don't care who it is. But, I mean, there are other sports in New York as well. We can see the Islanders. They just have their 10-game winning streak snapped. They're second in the Metropolitan Division. The NYCFC club got close. They got very close. Unfortunately, they did lose in the playoffs to Toronto FC 2-1, bouncing them out the playoffs. I believe that championship game is yet to be played. But what about New York State? Everybody about the Bills? They're 6-2. They're 6-2 behind the Patriots. Maybe New York City is not going to get a parade, but maybe New York State. What are we thinking?
I mean, they're looking better than the shots of our Jets and Giants, who don't even really play in New York. So, I mean, don't sleep on the Bills. You're right. And that Bills Nation, Bills Army, whatever they have up there, they're wild. So they're going to...
They're a herd.
Yeah,
they've been knocking on the door for years. And, like, they are New York's true football team, because you see the Jets and the Giants play at MetLife in New Jersey. So
it's
fun to see them. There's obviously potential in them, but who knows?
You know what? Don't discount our Johnnies either. Maybe we won't get a professional
could come
championship.
From St. John's.
Let's get a St. John's championship. I believe in that soccer team.
We are New York sports
and
team.
And I think one thing, though, looking forward beyond New York sports, looking at United States sports as a whole, there's a lot of great things going on with our national teams, and especially so ahead of the Olympics that are coming up. I mean, we got to vote USA all the way and root for our country in the Olympics coming up, and I think that's going to be exciting, and I think that's going to be a distraction from New York sports, because I'm not entirely sure that they're going to take on top of anything. So,
well, you know what? Me, if I can't root for my city, I'm going to root for my country. All right? That's all I'm going to say.
Of course.
Before we wrap things up, you know, I really want to thank you guys, Missy, Michael, for joining us on this panel. This was a fantastic time. What a great conversation. Be sure to like and subscribe to our YouTube channel, WRED-TV, and click the notifications bell to stay up to date with all of our latest content. You can also like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter and Instagram, once again, at WRED-TV. From all of us here, I'm Dariel Tolentino. Have a great night.